Welcome to Connective Tissue, Classification, and Cells. I'm Dr. Catherine Moore, the Histology Wizard. The three components that make up connective tissue proper are fibers, a hydrated gel-like ground substance, and cells. Together, the fibers and ground substance comprise the extracellular matrix, which, unlike other tissue types that consist mostly of cells, the major component of connective tissue is the extracellular matrix. But the third component of connective tissue is comprised of resident and transient cells. Today I'll be introducing some of the different types of connective tissue, along with the specific cells that reside and function in that tissue. We'll come back to the specialized connective tissues such as blood, bone, and cartilage, and go into more details about cell functions in later videos. Now keep in mind that we'll look at and discuss connective tissue in virtually every body system in this unit, so there will be plenty of opportunities for reinforcement of major concepts and details. Let's start with the basic functions of connective tissue. First, it provides a structural and protective matrix that supports and physically connects tissues and cells together to form organs. The interstitial fluid of connective tissue gives metabolic support to cells, since nutrients and waste products can diffuse through the tissue. Other functions include defense and repair. There are different types of connective tissue: connective tissue proper, which we'll discuss today, and specialized connective tissues, such as cartilage, bone, and blood, that will be the focus of other videos. All connective tissue proper originates from mesoderm, or more precisely, embryonic mesenchyme, which develops from mesoderm. There are several definitions for mesenchyme, depending upon who you ask, but for our purposes, we'll define it as consisting of a mostly viscous ground substance with a few collagen fibers and cells. Mesenchymal cells are largely undifferentiated. They have large nuclei, and they look sort of spindle-shaped. Importantly, they're multipotent and have the ability to migrate from their point of origin in the body to surround and penetrate developing organ systems and give rise to a number of different cell types. Connective tissue proper can be subdivided based upon the proportion of fibers. So we have loose connective tissue, dense connective tissue, which can be subdivided even further based on the arrangement of fibers, into dense regular and irregular types. Now we'll go ahead and discuss the appearance and characteristics of each type. Let's start with loose connective tissue. This is the most abundant connective tissue, and it's characterized by more cells and fewer fibers. So when you think of loose, this term actually relates to the fibers, not the cells. And the tissue really is physically loose and pliable. Here you see an electron micrograph showing some of these fibers, and an H&E stain section showing the large number of cells. Most connective tissue cell types are found in loose connective tissue. Loose connective tissue is located under all epithelia, it sheathes blood vessels, and it fills the spaces between organs. Here are a couple examples from the digestive system. First, we see the lamina propria of the duodenum, and then the ileum. And notice in both these examples, it's very hard to see actual fibers, but you can obviously see cells. Moving on, we'll look at dense irregular connective tissue. As seen in the electron micrograph, this tissue has more fibers, and these fibers are thicker than in loose connective tissue, making it tough and resistant to stretching. And there are also fewer cells. The hallmark of dense irregular connective tissue is that the fibers are arranged randomly. Now you'll find dense irregular connective tissue in the deeper dermal layer of skin, as protective capsules surrounding organs, and in the submucosal layer of the digestive organs. You can note here the almost rope-like arrangement of the fibers and the relative lack of cells compared to the loose connective tissue samples. One thing to remember is that the transition from loose to dense irregular connective tissue can often be arbitrary, but loose will always be closer, for example, to the epithelium as shown by the asterisks here in this skin example. In the digestive system, the layers are easier to distinguish, since there's almost always a muscle layer between the connective tissue layers. The different types of connective tissue have different functions, and that's true even in the same organ. For example, in the intestine shown here, the loose connective tissue of the lamina propria is not only flexible enough to allow the epithelium movement, but it supplies blood and nutrients to the epithelial tissue and provides transport for absorbed nutrients back to the body. The dense irregular connective tissue of the submucosa provides structure and support. This is also where larger blood vessels and the enteric nervous system is located that controls large peristaltic movements. Now I'll show you a real-life example of dense irregular connective tissue. Did you know that the casings that hold your brats, hot dogs, and sausages together are made of the submucosa? The last type of connective tissue is dense regular connective tissue. As the name suggests, this tissue is dense with more fibers and fewer cells, but in this case, the fibers are arranged in a parallel direction. You can easily see in these two electron micrographs of irregular and regular connective tissue the random versus parallel arrangement of the fibers. The number of cells is fewest in the dense regular tissue with just a few fibroblasts wedged in between the collagen fibers. Dense regular connective tissue is only found in tendons and ligaments. Here's an example of a tendon. Note the parallel arrangement of fibers and the small number of fibroblasts between the collagen bundles in this magnified view. Before we move on to cells, I want to take a minute to highlight skin. As I mentioned earlier, skin's a great example of an organ with both loose and dense irregular connective tissue. Here, the first arrow shows the loose connective tissue under the epithelium, while the second arrow highlights the denser tissue with much thicker collagen bundles that lies in the dermis. So while we're here, let's mention some definitions that are specific to skin. First, we have that most superficial layer of the epidermis. Next, the deeper layer of the dermis, which contains blood vessels and nerves, as well as hair follicles and glands. And finally, we have the deepest layer, the hypodermis, which contains a large amount of adipose tissue. Now I'm going to go ahead and introduce the cell types that are found in connective tissue, but I want you to remember that we'll learn more about the functions of these cell types as we move through the unit. I told you that there are two groups of cells found in connective tissue, resident or tissue cells, and transient cells that are mostly cells of the immune system. We'll start by introducing the permanent or resident cells, which consists of fibroblasts, tissue macrophages, mast cells, and adipocytes. Now you'll note that adipose tissue is actually considered a specialized connective tissue, but we're going to go ahead and introduce the cells here. Fibroblasts are the most abundant connective tissue cell. They have many functions, some of which we don't fully understand, but these include secreting most of the connective tissue fibers and ground substance. They also have the ability to transform into myofibroblasts after damage, and they'll take on new abilities to contract and secrete matrix and cytokines. These are heavily involved in regeneration and repair. Hyperactivity or dysfunction of fibroblasts can lead to scarring, such as seen in this keloid scar, fibrosis, and disease. Next, we have the tissue macrophage, called histiocytes by pathologists. These cells derived from monocytes have phagocytic activity and are long-lived in tissue. There's another population of transient macrophages that can be recruited as a response to infection and inflammation. These cells are easy to distinguish in tissue. They have abundant lysosomes that appear as clear vesicles in tissue sections. So here we see several of those clear vesicles in H&E stain sections, but you can see that they are dark circles in this electron micrograph, and they are represented by the blue staining structures in these macrophages that are stained with a lysosomal marker. Macrophages are motile cells able to travel to sites of infection for cleanup, and they have abundant filopodia. These specializations allow macrophages to phagocytose bacteria and dead or damaged cells, to sense damage, and to secrete cytokines in order to recruit other immune cells. They're also critical for wound repair. Next, let's look at adipocytes, probably the most recognizable cell in the body. These clear-looking cells contain a single lipid droplet with a very thin rim of cytoplasm, and they have a flattened nucleus. Now, adipocytes were long thought to have the simple function of insulation and cushioning, but now we know these cells have critical functions in storing lipid as energy and in making hormones. And in fact, these cells are now known to be involved in a number of metabolic diseases. Mast cells are our final type of resident cell in connective tissue. These dark cells with their abundant prominent granules are also very easy to spot in connective tissue. Mast cells function in the inflammatory response. They store and release histamine, heparin, and leukotrienes. Once thought to be derived from basophils, it's now known that while they do arise from bone marrow, they have a progenitor that is distinct from the basophil lineage. Now, in addition to these more permanent cells, there are a number of cells that are transient in connective tissue, and these all happen to be immune cells. So we see lymphocytes, plasma cells, and neutrophils and eosinophils. Let's look at each of these. First, we have the lymphocyte, these small white blood cells that have a darkly staining nucleus and very little cytoplasm. There are two types of lymphocytes, T and B lymphocytes, and that have different functions in the immune response. There are usually a few lymphocytes in connective tissue, although the exceptions are the respiratory tract and the GI tract. In this image on the left, you can see a large aggregate of small dark cells below the epithelium. And in the enlarged image on the right, you can see that these cells are mostly lymphocytes. Now, B lymphocytes give rise to plasma cells. These cells have a characteristic nucleus that's located to the side of the cell, or eccentric, and they show clock face heterochromatin, reflecting the high activity of the cell. The plasma cell also contains a large Golgi apparatus, reflecting the enormous amount of protein production, and this gives the cell a white patch that's very easy to see. Interestingly, despite their name, plasma cells aren't normally found in the blood. They're made in the bone marrow, and they live in tissue. And again, the job of these cells is to produce antibodies. Last but not least, we have neutrophils and eosinophils, two more transient immune cells that can be recruited to connective tissue. The neutrophil is the EMT of the immune system, responding first to damage and infection. It's hands down the most recognizable white blood cell with its multilobe nucleus and granules, but the eosinophil runs a close second with its bright orange-red granules. Finally, I'll leave you with a summary of all the major connective tissue cell types. As we move through the unit and through the body systems, we'll add more details about the functions and associated pathologies of these cells. Now that's it for today, and thanks for stopping by.